back in 2018, Kara Eastman came within 1.9%, or just about 5,000 votes out of almost 250,000 votes cast, of unseating the incumbent Republican in the 2nd Congressional District in Nebraska. Now, you would think when Kara decided to run again in 2020 for the same seat, the party would say, "Hey, that's damn good. What a great result in 2018. We're going to rally around you now." Well, you'd be wrong. And that party elite nonsense goes back to 2018 when Kara defeated a Blue Dog Democrat, favored by the party apparatchiks in the Democratic primary. Right, that would be just before she came close to winning the seat, and probably would have won if the party elites had gotten over the childish, sulking behavior and thrown in with her campaign once she was the nominee. Well, she's not backing down, and she's back for another run. And Kara joins me to talk about the campaign. And there are so many weighty issues on your website, Kara, and you've been a veteran campaigner. The most important thing that jumped out to me, and I really want to get this on the record and very clear, have you in fact found the best wings in Nebraska, which apparently is one of your lifelong goals or campaign goals?
Yes, I tend to have very lofty goals, and I have found, I would say, I can't imagine a better chicken wing than at a local restaurant in Omaha called Tracks. And the thing that's so amazing about them is that they grill them and then also put them in the sauce, and so it's a perfect wing.
Huh. So when you win this seat next year, they'll probably have a big, huge picture of you with your face all full of the sauce and so on, digging into those wings. They'll probably name something after you.
I would be honored to have a chicken wing named after me, but no, there will never be a picture of me covered in sauce.
you don't want to make the Michael Dukakis mistake of, at least in the chicken wing variety.
That's right. Exactly.
Okay. So to be a little bit more serious, I mean, you and I spoke on this program over 2 years ago in June of 2018 when you were running in the primary. And the thing about this is you won the primary. You defeated the preferred candidate of the DCCC, the Inside the Beltway Washington folks. And you came really close to actually winning the general election, only short 5,000 votes out of 250,000 cast, under 2%. So you came really close to winning a slightly Republican district. And I'm wondering, first of all, how has the establishment responded to you now, given that you show that you actually know how to campaign, you know how to appeal to the voters in that district?
Yeah, we ran such a strong grassroots campaign that I'm really proud of. And I didn't necessarily know how the Democratic Party would respond to my jumping back in the race. To be honest, I think candidates are usually recruited or convinced to run. And so I was never that candidate. I did this a lot on my own with the help of friends and family members and people that I trust and respect. And they were not apparently super excited about the idea of my running. They actually recruited somebody to run against me in the primary. But which is unfortunate. And I'm sure there are all kinds of reasons we could speculate as to why that has happened, but the reality is I am true to who I am. I'm not taking corporate PAC money, running on progressive issues that people care about, and I believe the party, at least from conversations I've had with the DCCC recently, they believe I'm going to win the primary, and so it's kind of an interesting scenario.
And I think you mentioned perhaps a core reason that they were very suspicious of you in that you don't take corporate PAC money. And unfortunately, too many of the candidates, the Democratic Party's candidates, do run on corporate PAC money. In fact, the DCCC has no problem taking that kind of money. So I assume, and it's not just true about you, I assume that anytime someone says, "I'm not for corporate PAC money, I'm a progressive," that people look at it with quite a bit of suspicion.
Yes, I think that's very possible. And it's a shame because what it's resulted in is a government and elected officials who work for the, you know, corporations and the very wealthy over regular working people. And we need to change that model. And I think what we're seeing is this momentum where people are starting to understand that this is possible with some of the people that got elected in 2018. And I think that momentum is carried into this election where people are tired. They're tired of corruption in politics. They're tired of a government that doesn't work for them. And they're tired of feeling like their voice doesn't count.
And you were telepathic because I was actually going to suggest, and let's talk a little bit more about this. There's a different mood, I think, in the country. It started actually in 2018, perhaps a little bit before that, but it certainly started in 2018 with candidates like yourself, progressive candidates who ran all across the country on issues like Medicare for all, a fair wage for working people, raising the minimum wage, a big investment in infrastructure to deal with climate change. And all of a sudden, that's really the buzz and the central part of the conversation that's happening within the party and frankly in the country. And I'm wondering if you're now seeing that in terms of the people that you're appealing to, voters, when you're knocking on doors, when you're talking to people, have you seen that shift in people's perceptions and the conversations you're having?
We have. And we have already started making voter contacts. We've made quite a few. And that is exactly what's happening. They are these ideas, which it's funny because when you lay them out the way that you did, they're so common sense. They're so rational. They're pragmatic. They actually save money. And they get to the core of what's wrong in our country with big problems that we have to have big solutions to solve. But it's funny because when you just listed them out, I'm like, those are really, I mean, people having healthcare, having a livable wage, having clean air and water, those are such simple, they seem so simple, right? And what we're hearing is people coming around to these ideas that they're not really radical, but rather the way that we get to real change in this country where people have a voice and where people who are working two or three jobs finally get to say, you know what, this could be a different system. Like, I'm seeing that there's this possibility of change in this country on a large scale that would actually impact people living in poverty, people of color, people who have just not necessarily had a loud voice. And people are excited. They're excited that there's a candidate here that is willing to speak up and represent them.
And to your point, one of the things you have in your website is a section about income inequality, and you lead with this sentence: the World Bank puts our income inequality on par with some of the poorest and unequal nations in the world, which is actually a stunning realization. I mean, many of us know that, but I think you say that in such clear and easy language for people to read that sentence and say, oh my goodness. And then you say, this is dangerous for our economy. And explain what you mean by that.
Well, when we have an economy that is solely tilted towards a very small portion of the population and leaves everyone else out, we are all susceptible to issues, right? We are a much better society. We're much better neighborhoods. We're much better communities when everyone is healthy, when everyone is educated, when we're not victimized by gun violence. And when income inequality is not vastly out of control, because we don't, you know, most of us actually live in a world where we visit other parts of our communities, where we're driving around, we're going to restaurants and coffee shops and frequenting business in other parts, not just exactly where we live. And if you're not doing that, you should, right? But in order to have healthy, robust communities, we can't have such disparities in income because it impacts all of us. Now, also in the United States of America, where we have the largest economy of any country in the world, we can certainly afford to make sure that we have the things that we need and that we're actually looking out for the 9% of people who do not reside within that 1% of extreme wealth. It just seems like the balance of power, the balance of money, and the balance of influence needs to switch and to shift over to the majority of people. And one of the ways we do that is by running as unapologetic progressive Democrats who are saying, we're not going to take corporate PAC money. We're not going to be beholden to large corporations. And we're actually going to put the needs and the will and the good of the people over everything else.
And I assume that you are finding that kind of issue and that kind of approach, those kinds of stances, those progressive ideas are just as relevant to Nebraska, which people don't necessarily think is progressive, say like Queens, New York, or Manhattan. That's not the perception of people, but your district is quite urban, but still it's Nebraska and people have a sense that it's at least more conservative. But it sounds like what you're saying is these kinds of issues appeal to people no matter where they are, at least self-perception where they are on the political spectrum.
Right. Well, and that makes sense, right? Because they're pragmatic, practical issues that are actually in line with the vast majority of Americans. Most Americans agree that we need, you know, universal background checks when it comes to gun safety. The majority of Americans agree we need a livable wage, that we need to do something about climate change. 53% of Republicans think that we need a government universal health care program. So these are all very popular ideas. And what's interesting about Nebraska is we used to be a prairie progressive state. We had, a couple decades ago, we had Democratic governors, mayors in Omaha, senators, and so we haven't always been this deep red state. And I think frustration with both parties has led to a point where people are just frustrated with the system. They're frustrated that they feel like they aren't being heard by their leaders. And I think that that is in part what got Donald Trump elected. And so we need for people to go out and speak out. And I understand that I might be the first candidate in this district to be leading that charge. And I think I can win on it. Otherwise, I wouldn't be doing it again. But we're creating a movement and people are starting to wake up and see that there can be something different. And in Nebraska, sometimes it takes us a minute to embrace new ideas. I remember when one of the first sushi places opened in Omaha, we were like, what's that? and now we have sushi places all over Omaha. So I think it absolutely can be done. But I think it takes a grassroots movement. It takes a lot of hard work. And I imagine it might take two cycles of running for Congress to get people to realize that I am who I say I am and that I'm not backing away from my ideas, but that I am truly somebody who's going to listen to people who live in this district from any party and really put the needs of the district before a political party, before what corporations want, and I'm going to do what's best for the district.
I just want to make sure, and I won't ask you your position about sushi versus wings because we don't want to get into a huge, big scandal, right? We'll just leave it at that.
Right. Well, and that might take up the whole podcast.
Okay. Now to circle back to be more serious, I noted that in your healthcare position, you didn't explicitly say that you're on board or supporting Medicare for All or a specific program. You talk about, obviously, that healthcare is a human right. There's a crisis. Drug prices are too high. So explain a little bit about your vision about how we solve the healthcare crisis. Are you a Medicare for All proponent?
Well, and the reason we did that is one, we actually don't have any specific policy proposal listed on the website because they've changed over time and we didn't want people to be confused about where I stand on things. And so right now, what I'm hearing from people is that there's confusion between the concept of Medicare for All and then the specific bills that are out there. And so I'm starting with the values, right? I believe healthcare is a human right. We cannot afford the path we're on, and we need a system where we are actually saving people and the government money, and where people can actually have freedom of choice when it comes to their physicians, their nurses, their clinics. Because right now we've got the whole in-network, out-of-network thing, which I've never understood. I don't think most people get it. Right now we have prescription drugs that are out of control. And doctors are feel limited by insurance companies of how they can practice medicine. So there is a specific bill that Pramila Jayapal has introduced, which is, falls under the Medicare for All Act. And I think that's the name of it. But that fixes Medicare. It provides for long-term care. It provides for vision, dental, and hearing, and actually creates a system where there are no longer financial barriers to accessing healthcare, and it saves money over time. And I think that that is one of the most critical pieces, that when we're looking at healthcare in our country and the projected costs of healthcare at soon getting to rises of 5% every year, our outcomes are so poor compared to how much we're spending. We need a different system.
I know it's on your mind as a smart political person, and I wonder whether it's on the minds of voters that Medicare for All is a great concept. I totally support it, but do people consider the political practicalities of trying to pass it? And I'm speaking specifically of where all good policy proposals go to die, which is the United States Senate. I mean, the practical reality is that if the Democrats don't control the Senate, Medicare for All will not become a reality. And in fact, if the Democrats, by some good fortune, control the Senate at best by, say, 51 or 52 votes, they have one or two vote majority, they're going to be pretty conservative Democrats there who don't support Medicare for All. So how do you envision being a leader in the House and trying to push that? Is it about pushing the envelope and changing the conversation so we eventually get there, and noting to voters that it may not happen the first year?
I don't think so. Because I think that there are many scenarios where this becomes priority one. And because healthcare is the number one thing we hear from voters at the doors, and it's the reason why I want to go to Congress. I want to fix our healthcare system and be involved in that in whatever possible way. So do I think that if we don't have a different president and we don't flip the Senate and that's possible? I think that there are changes that are possible. But I think if we actually are able to change this presidency, you know, pick up seats in the Senate and also have some more campaigns that are out there pushing for this concept of expanded healthcare in a way that it's not spreading misinformation. And I'm actually kind of disappointed at the way that the misinformation has spread about these issues. I think there's a real opportunity here to do something incredible for Americans that they want done.
Well, I've often suggested and often wondered why we simply don't make the economic case, and that really every single business should be in favor of Medicare for All because of all the money that small businesses, large businesses spend on healthcare costs, and that every CEO in America, if they had a moral understanding, but also if they just looked at it from strict economic standpoint, they would be in favor of Medicare for All, because you would free up all that money to do things that are now being essentially underwritten, or essentially money's being wasted on healthcare costs.
Yeah, it's funny. I just had a conversation with the CEO of a pizza franchise in Nebraska, and he said they spend $700,000 a year on healthcare for their employees. And I looked at him and said, "Well, what else? What could you do if you didn't have to spend that $700,000?" And his eyes got huge. And then we had a great conversation of the ways that he could invest. And the first thing he said, "Well, is everybody gets raises." I mean, this would significantly impact businesses and their employees. And that's where our focus should be going.
And last question I'll throw out at you is the issue of climate change, partly because you, and I think others, but certainly it's great to see that you are highlighting it, and you call it the number one moral and security threat our nation faces. And again, to get practical, I mean, my goodness, Nebraska would be the perfect place to have a ton of windmills everywhere, right? You've got lots of wind across the plains, and you could really lead the nation in showing how those kinds of alternative energies could work, especially, again, in Nebraska, because of the way in which wind is such a, you know, a regular fact of life.
That's right. That's right. We are a very windy and sunny state, and our farming communities have been decimated by the combination of climate change and tariffs. And we should be leading the world in wind power. And we are. And I've talked to some of the experts in the wind industry, and basically they're saying, like, it's just political will, that we just need to get new leaders in charge, and we could lead the country and the world in this. And this is an area where we don't have time to wait. It's not okay for politicians to say they don't believe the science, or they're not ready for this, or that bold solutions are not too lofty, especially when we're tying this economic development and workforce development. And so this is the time for a green economic revolution, and we can do that where we're making great paying jobs that are union jobs, where we're investing in infrastructure, that's all local stuff, and that where we're not outsourcing these things to other countries. Like, this is the time, because we don't have time to wait.